as we mentioned, it wasn't the only thing to launch to Mars during this window. We had our second of three potential ones this year. Well, like I said, second of kind of four, but we already know that ESA is off the table. We're still hoping that NASA's Perseverance rover will launch, hopefully next week, basically, on the 31st, I think. So a week from tomorrow for us recording, or a week for today, or those of you listening in the future. I think it's planning to launch on the 31st. And so that's still like the third one that could launch this year. But the second one happened just last night for us in the United States. And this was China launching, believe it or not, the heaviest, most ambitious launch to Mars ever. They went from, hey, we're going to put a little tiny thing on top of a Russian rocket like a couple years ago to, screw it. We're going to use the heaviest rocket we have in the capable and send the biggest payload to Mars ever. And it went off very well last night. This was Tianwen-1. I know I'm mispronouncing that, and I have, and I'm so sorry. But it launched on top of their Long March 5 rocket, which is almost, it's a good medium class rocket. I thought it was a heavy lift launcher. I forgot. I got confused last night. But it's not. It's about as high performance as a fully expendable Falcon Heavy. It can take 25 tons to low Earth orbit. It's actually similar in payload capability to a fully reused Falcon Heavy. When the Falcon Heavy has the boosters land back at land, it's similar in performance to that, actually. And what's cool about this mission, though, is so not only, obviously, like I said, is it the biggest thing to ever go to Mars at around five tons ish. The exciting thing is it's not only going to have an orbiter, it also will have a lander and a little rover attached to it too. So it's basically like a trifecta. They're sending an orbiter, a lander that lands and has some instrumentation on board, and a rover. Like, they're just going all in.
Okay.
And
sorry, this picture is really freaking me out. Like, it's on Mars, but Mars is in the atmosphere, and the Earth is like 30 miles away.
I don't think this is to scale.
Mars is orbiting Mars.
Mars is orbiting Mars in this picture, and Earth is a moon of Mars.
Yeah. It's planet 9. It's on planet 9. Okay.
That's what I didn't even quite. When I saw this, I'm just like, I'm just looking at the hardware. I wasn't remotely looking at. Now that you point that out, wow. Yeah. It's perfect.
Well, the first thing I thought was, I can see Saudi Arabia from Mars. Is that right? I don't think that's right. Oh, what's this other Mars orbiting Mars over here?
Mars.
I don't think that's right either. Sorry, go ahead.
No, it's cool, though. This is like the only image we actually have of the rover. Pretty good sized rover, about 250 kilograms, if I remember right, is what's actually going to the surface of Mars. So not huge, but that's fine. I mean, 250 kilograms, it seems a lot like a Spirit Opportunity sized rover with solar panels and all that stuff. So hopefully that mission works well. That, again, their Long March 5 rocket is what launched last night. And that's, I didn't know too much about that rocket, so I kind of briefly studied up on it, and I'm impressed. They're using liquid hydrogen, a closed cycle for their liquid hydrogen for their core stages, and then RP-1 on their booster stages. And they're using closed cycle oxygen rich, very similar to like the RD-180 and the NK-33 and stuff. And it's probably likely because they bought those plans or used those plans basically for their own rocket. But yeah, it's impressive.
Have they launched the Long March 5 before? Because I've heard of it before, but I didn't know like if it was a brand new vehicle.
It's launched five times. Okay. Had a failure on the second one. So it's relatively new and not launched very well, very often. They launched it earlier this year successfully. And they have another version of it called the Long March 5B, which is a low Earth orbit version that's dedicated for low Earth orbit. And actually has, it's weird, even though it's for low Earth orbit, it has an additional stage, but it's, I think it's more of like a kick stage. So they can do kind of like how the Electron has that little Curie upper stage. Yeah. So they can, once it's in orbit, they can kind of place satellites in different different orbits and yeah, stuff like that.
Yeah.
This brings up a discussion point, though. I would love to hear you guys' opinions on this. And again, friendly reminder, if you're listening, this is maybe going to slide as political as I'm ever going to get, because I don't like to be political, but
you're getting me excited now.
But it's a valid topic. I had like emails saying like, how dare you live stream this launch? You're supporting new age Nazis. Like, would you have live streamed the V2 rocket? And I'm like, this was okay. And they're like, you, how dare you not talk about the genocide? How dare you not talk about this, this, and this, all these horrendous things that the Chinese Communist Party has done? Like, so hold on. Am I supposed to do a report on every government agency doing a launch? Like, okay, so this launch is from the United States. As you know, the United States in 1922 did a, you know, like, am I supposed to ethically have to prelude my coverage of scientific missions and engineering and rockets and spaceflight with, and somehow vie off on all of the country's wrongdoings before I do a launch coverage?
Yes, Tim, that's what you're supposed to do, just so you know. So they were mad because they're mad at China about stuff they're doing, which is legit stuff to be mad at China about.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, the whole...
I mean, human rights, and of course, like, there's huge issues with the country, but the point of my channel is obviously to focus on spaceflight and to focus on space exploration and science. So, and I kept saying that, like, guys, please, we're here to focus on this, like, of... Let's not talk politics. Like, yes, well, of course, it's political in nature, but like, I'm here to cover the most ambitious Mars mission ever. And I think we can come together on that and be excited in that potential and that possibility.
Well, it reminds me, I was just watching Fully Charged with Robert Llewellyn, one of my favorite channels, and he was talking about people got really mad that they did a review of the Xiaopeng P7. Which I was calling XPeng. I did a video on it as well. They actually have a guy, Elliot, in China that did a hands-on review of it. And same kind of comments saying, I would never buy anything made in China. And the irony is, chances are you're commenting on this video with that from something made in China.
That was my immediate thought when Tim was talking about that. Like, these people are so angry, they're doing it on something that was made in China.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that's a broader thing that we have to think about, of separating the work from the, like, the art from the artist kind of a thing. You know, with the whole Me Too movement, there was a lot of those things. Like, I could never watch Star Wars the same way again, or whatever movies Harvey Weinstein was a part of. But those kind of things.
For the record, he was not a part of Star Wars, but go ahead. Sorry.
Okay. Yeah, I'm sure someone will be mad about that. What name a movie that he was a part of? Matrix?
Anything that Miramax did. So, Pulp Fiction. E.T. No. Not that far back.
Okay, anyways. Point being, can you separate those things, right? Can you separate... Because, the whole... I forget how to say it. Uyghurs, the 1 million Muslims that are in re-education / concentration camps currently in China. Mm. Yeah, absolutely... horrendous, insane when you look at that stuff. But can you separate them and what they're doing there from any of these other things, like making your iPhone, for example?
Well,
I think we have to, otherwise the whole world like wouldn't function, because everyone is part good and part bad. You know, like the U.S. is no exception. We're not, you know, the only ones that have never sinned in the world. Clearly the U.S. has done terrible things. So does that mean you can't do trust anything from the U.S. either? Like, I don't know where is the slippery slope of that conversation? Like, where does it lead to? You're Amish and you just live off the land without electronics or yes, that's fine. If you said yes, that's where I want to be, and you're Amish, how are you commenting on this? But you know, where does it go? Like, where does that lead to?
I want to hear Joe's thoughts on this, and then I've got more to say, because this got me really going.
You know, we're all on YouTube. We're used to getting lovely comments. I mean, I was talking before we got on that, you know, I in my last video used the term BCE instead of BC, and I actually got a comment from somebody saying that was hate speech against Christians. You know, people bring into whatever it is that we do with their own
lens,
perspectives, and their own baggage, their own life, whatever, you know. And there's definitely a cadre of people out there that are just like very angry at China for those human rights violations. There's some people that blame China for coronavirus, you know. You could go into whether race plays a part in any of this, but that's kind of where I am with my channel. It's like people are just going to bring into it what they're going to bring into it, and I have no control over that. you know, yeah. And all I can do is try to do what's right for my channel and be what's, you know, congruent for my channel. So speaking to your situation here, Tim, you cover spaceflight. So what were you doing? You were covering spaceflight. You know, it's it's not your job to comment on human rights abuses in China and stuff like that.
It's like literally, that's not my
It's literally job. Not your job.
Like, I think
doesn't mean you don't care.
Right. Right.
You know, it's just
that's like telling the Target employee that why aren't you arresting that person out in the parking lot that just beat up that other person? Like, I work at Target. I'm not a police officer. What are you talking about? Like, what? Yeah. You know, like, it's not my job. I care. And again, if you're like a Target employee seeing someone get beat up in the parking lot, you probably care about that. But it's not your job to take care of that, you know, or to address that per se. Yeah. So for me, what really sucks is like I'm trying again to focus on the science and the engineering. And you have to think about the hundreds of thousands of people or the thousands of people that work on these projects that are in this. They're in their world and they're working really hard and doing incredible things eventually, whether you agree with it or not, for humanity, like, period. And are they doing atrocities against their people, those scientists and engineers? No, you don't choose what country you're born into. You know, they don't have a choice that they were born in a country that might be doing things, you know, that are egregious. Like, that's not the scientist's choice. Just like Wernher von Braun, perfect example of born in Germany at the wrong time as it became Nazi Germany, and was forced to use his knowledge to develop weapons, even though all the guy ever wanted to do was explore space. In the grand scheme of things, it turned out great because he got an insane amount of fun. Please do not turn this into like Nazi sympathizing, but at the end of the day, he received a large amount of funds to develop rocket technology, you know? And would that have happened if there wasn't that horrible regime? I don't know. Like, again, I'm not saying that that's a good thing, but I'm just saying, like, in perspective, in the grand scheme of history, he didn't choose where he was born, and he didn't choose, you know, to have to be forced to work under these people. He had no option. It was either that or die, you know. And now look at where we're at because of it. Like, in the grand scheme of history, you know, thank God Wernher von Braun was born, because he was the person that really solved and helped figure out him and Korolev, you know, like, figured out how to do all this spaceflight stuff that we all now is a huge integrated part of every one of our lives.
Yeah. No, I have before mentioned him in a video and gotten a comment or two about, like, how dare you, you know, praise a Nazi or something like that.
Yeah, it's like,
and it's like, but he also created our space program, you know? Hey guys, thanks so much for watching this clip from our show. If that's just not enough for you and you want to watch the full episode, you can go to olfpod.com/YT.
And if you want more from us, you can consider becoming a Patreon member. You'll get early access to episodes. You can join our awesome community. You can actually watch us record live and get your name in the credits by going to olfpod.com/Patreon.
So thanks everyone for watching. Check back every Friday for new clips here and new episodes on the main channel.
Thanks everybody.